brothers and sisters, let's open our Bible now to the book of Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. And we looked at before in the past the two ways, which were the broad way and the narrow way that Jesus spoke of. And last time we looked at the two trees in the last Bible study when we look at the regular line versus the irregular line part 6. And this part here, this sermon here, and this Bible study here, what we want to look at, we want to look at a continuation of the regular line versus irregular line, but also addressing the question, the issue of what is a church. Because many have this misunderstanding. By many, I'm referring to Seventh-day Adventists. They have this misunderstanding of what a church is. Well, even though the Bible plainly says that the church are the people who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Notice now, it does not say it is a specific organization. It says it's the people that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Case in point, as we looked at before, when Jesus came to the regular line in his days and looked for, and they rejected him, he turned to another class. Sister White says this, that he turned to another class who would be obedient to the law of God and who would be willing to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. So God is not bound really by our in organization. I have received phone calls, emails, and messages on YouTube because of the last message that we put out on regular line part 6. Regular line versus irregular line, part 6. And I've had email from folks. I believe they were honest and sincere. I'll give them the benefits of the doubt. But they were mistaken when they associate the conference or the general conference as the church. When Sister White, over and over, when she talks of the church, she never refers to the conference as the church. She refers to, like the Bible refers to, as those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. She even says in one place that the church are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, where two or three are gathered together in my name. That is the church, she says. So the church is not bound by an organization. Now, I want all of you, especially those of you who are Seventh-day Adventists, and this message is specifically for Seventh-day Adventists. So those of you who are Seventh-day Adventists who are struggling with this idea, what is a church? I want you to follow along very carefully in this study. Notice now, Jesus again is taking us using how many ways are there? There's only two ways. There's only the God's way, and there's your way or the devil's way. He used the parables of the narrow way and also the two trees. And also now we are looking at the two foundations. Notice now, Jesus says in verse 24, therefore, whosoever heareth these saying of mine, notice now, whosoever heareth this saying of mine, so that is what will constitute the church. Those who hear the word of God and follow it and be obedient to them, that's what made up the church. Not an organization, as many of you think. Notice now, one more time, verse 24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which build, notice now, his house upon a rock. And the house there, it's referring to, that's the church. That's what Jesus says. Upon this rock, he said that to Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. And so whoever heareth, notice now, whoever heareth the saying of Jesus Christ upon this rock, he is the rock, upon this rock, he says, I will put that church. Those who obey, those who remain, and who has a firm foundation on that rock, I will build my church on it. That's what became the church. It goes on to say, verse 25 now, and the rain descended. Notice now, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded, notice now, upon a rock. And the rain there, it's a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And the wind there also represent the Holy Spirit. But also the wind, according to the Bible, can also represent the false doctrines as well. But notice now, which spirit then is it referring to? That is the Spirit of God. When the Holy Spirit comes with force, just like the Holy Spirit fell upon the disciples on the day of Pentecost. Now, the disciples were able to stand that wind, the fire of the Holy Spirit that fell upon them. Why? Because at that time, they were standing on a firm foundation, the rock of our foundation, Jesus Christ. And so they were unmovable. And instead of being blown away by the wind, by the fire, they were empowered to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what would happen when the winds, when the rains come, if we are founded on this firm foundation, Jesus Rock, our Lord and Savior, the Almighty God, we will not be moved. Instead, we will be empowered. Notice now, he goes on to say, verse 26, and everyone, notice the contrast, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth what happened them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which build his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house. What happened? Again, remember, a house represent a church. Then it says, and it fell. Then, and great was the fall of it. Notice now, two churches Jesus is referring to here. We're talking about, let's just put it this way, the two sides of the boat. Just like the two ways, just like the two trees. Remember the two ways again. Those who were on those paths, the narrow path, and those who were on the broad path, they were all Christians. They were part of the church, just like the trees that become, that the one tree that become corrupt and the other tree that bear fruit, they were represent the church, just like the boat. The boat has two sides, brothers and sisters. So now we have two foundations and two houses on that foundation. Well, as a matter of fact, wait a minute now, one house was founded upon the rock. The other one, where was the other one found? Where was its foundation? Upon the sand. But they both called themselves, pay attention now, they both called themselves the church of God. It had always been that way. There's always been two churches that call themselves Christians, that call themselves the body of Christ. It has always been that way. There's always been one that would do it God's way, and the other one still calling themselves now the church of God, the representative of God, but doing it their own way. We have that from the beginning. Cain and Abel, brothers and sisters, they were a very good example of that. Cain did it his way. Abel did it the God's way. It has always been that way, but they both profess to believe in the Almighty God. But the difference was, the one who did it God's way was the one who was the true church of God. And likewise, that's how it is now within the Seventh-day Adventists. The body of a Seventh-day Adventist, we have two groups among us. One that is doing it their way, that's the regular line. And the other one is the one that is doing it in God's way, that's the irregular line. And so therefore, which one of those two now that their foundation is found upon the rock. Notice now, you remember when Jesus says to Peter, as a matter of fact, let's go back there, Matthew chapter 16, notice now, in that passage there, this was after Jesus was questioning the disciples about whom men say that I am, and whom do you say that I am? And then Peter answered in verse 16 of Matthew 16, and Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said unto Peter, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee, notice now, that thou art Peter. Upon this rock I will build my, what is it? My church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And notice now, what made the difference there? Remember now, Peter said, unlike what everybody else was saying, unlike what the regular line was saying, the regular line was saying that he was not a true prophet, or he did not come from God. He was not of God. But Peter said, you are the Son of the living God. And so Jesus says, upon this rock, that's the rock, he's the rock, Jesus is the rock, I will build my church. Notice now, Jesus now, context, Jesus was talking to Peter. Now, Peter was one of the 12. That's very key there. Remember again, the regular line rejected Jesus. Now, which church did Jesus say that he was going to build upon himself? It was the irregular line. Oh, brothers and sisters, this is very significant. So, two churches. There was one. The Pharisees represent the church that was built upon sand. The irregular line represented the in Peter's day, the church that was built upon the rock, upon Jesus. And so Jesus said again, notice now, he says, therefore, verse 24 again, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not. For what happened? For it was founded upon a rock, and that is the rock of our foundation. So again, Jesus was talking to the disciples. He was talking to Peter after Peter acknowledged who Jesus was and say, basically, I'm going to stand with you. Even in John chapter 6, after the disciple describes the many of Jesus' disciples who had stopped following him because of present truth he presented to them, but they rejected that. Then Jesus turned to the 12. He says, will you also go away? Then Peter again was the one who says, where would we go, Master? You have the words of eternal life. I'm going to stick with you no matter what happened. I'm going to stick with you even though you are not popular now. That's what happened, brothers and sisters. Go with me now to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 18. And the Bible says, for through him we both have access. That through him there, that's Jesus Christ. That's the rock there. That's our foundation there. It says, for through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the womb, unto the Father. Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the, notice now, of the household of God. That's the church of God. And then it says here, and are, notice now, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being what? The chief cornerstone. And then verse 21 says, in whom, what happened? All the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also, notice now, speaking to you and I, in whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. And so, notice now, so if we are being built up on this foundation, through what again it says? Through the Spirit. Remember in Matthew chapter 7, it speaks of rain and the winds. And in John chapter 3, Jesus says of the Holy Spirit, it's like the wind that's blowing. You don't know where it comes and where it's going. And so in Matthew chapter 7, it speaks of winds blowing upon that house to test that house, to see if that house is standing upon the rock, the true rock, which is Jesus Christ. Winds also could represent false teaching. The house that was founded upon the sand. Notice with me now, as a matter of fact, in the book of Ephesians, same book, notice now in chapter 4 of Ephesians, which book we go into? The book of Ephesians, chapter 4, now this time in verse 14, speaking of winds, notice what it says here, that we henceforth be no more children, what happened? Toss to and fro. Why? What does that mean, to toss to and fro? That means to be swaying. It's like when the wind comes, when a tornado or a hurricane comes, if you're not built, if your house was not properly built, you will feel that the house is moving. But if the house, as the Bible tells us, is founded upon the rock, Jesus Christ, what happened when the wind comes, when the flood comes, when the rain comes? It will not be moved. It goes on to say one more time that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, how? And carried about with, notice now, every wind of what? Of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lay in wait to do what? To deceive. But notice now, it goes on to say, but speaking what? The truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. But speak the what? The truth. The Bible tells us, sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. Speak the truth in love. What is truth, asked Pilate? Well, the truth is the word of God. And the Bible tells us here, we must speak the truth in season and out of season. That means at any occasion. That means no compromise, regardless, because by proclaiming the truth at all times, it shows on which foundation that we are standing on, and therefore we will not be tossed to and fro by every kinds of winds or of doctrines, brothers and sisters. And so we want to make sure that we are standing on the truth, on the firm foundation. Notice another passage with me now. This time going to the book of Isaiah. We go into the book of Isaiah. But unfortunately, brothers and sisters, that was not always the case with the regular line in Jesus' days, even during the time of Isaiah. Notice now, in Isaiah chapter 8, beginning in verse 11, it says, for the Lord speak thus to me with a strong hand, and instructed me that I should not walk, notice now, in the way of this people. Notice now, which people is the Lord is counseling Isaiah here not to walk in the way or the path? It's referring to the regular line of Isaiah. But notice now, Isaiah now and others who were in a similar position as Isaiah were represent that other part of the church, or that part, other part of the boat. They were the ones doing the work in an irregular way while there was apostasy in the land. There's always two churches from the very beginning. two classes that claim to be the church of God. The same thing within Seventh-day Adventists. We have two sides of this boat, the regular line and the irregular line. But those who are doing the work in an irregular way, usually God raised them up because the regular line has gone away from the truth and have moved from the rock of their foundation to our ascending foundation. And so therefore now God had to raise others that would stand fast. Oh, brothers and sisters, others that would come and stand fast, that would be repairer of the breach, that would stand fast and that would uphold God's law by standing up on the rock of our foundation, so that when the storms of life comes, when the trial comes, when temptation comes, the world can see a people standing up for God, so that they can be drawn to them and to lead them to Jesus Christ, to the truth, because it's the truth that will set them free. And notice now, verse 12, it says, "Say ye not a confederacy to all them to whom this people shall say, a confederacy, neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid." Notice now, "Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your what? Your fear, and let him be your dread." Notice with me now, verse 14, "And he shall be for a what? A sanctuary, a place of refuge, a foundation, a sure place that we can go, that will keep us from the storm of life." Again, "And he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone," what is it? "Of stumbling, and for a rock of offense to both of the houses of Israel, for again, and for a snare to the inhabitants of what? Of Jerusalem." Notice the context there in verse 13 and verse 14. God called Isaiah to rebuke the sin of the regular line. So Isaiah and others who were standing up, they were in the minority. Let's read verse 14 again. Let's read verse 13 rather. Let's read that verse again. It says, "Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear, and let him be your dread." At that point, the people had no fear of God, and that's the reason why they move off. They move away from the foundation, from our rock. But God raised a few others. Likewise, brothers and sisters, God will always do this work whenever the regular line have gone away from God and have gone into apostasy and have gone into after the ways of the world. God will always raise those on that other side of the boat to cry out. As a matter of fact, Sister White tells us that based on Ezekiel chapter 9, she says those, the only ones who had received the seal of God on their forehead, were the only ones who were crying and sighing for the abomination that was being done in the land. Who caused the abomination? Who went into apostasy? It was the regular line. Who were the ones crying and sighing? It was those who were doing the work in an irregular way and calling others and try to help others to see the apostasy. And as you continue to read Ezekiel chapter 9, the Bible tells us that the angels that God sent to slay those who were in apostasy, they were not the only one who were killed. The Bible says, "Slay both men, both women and children and men." And so many who remain there in that apostasy receive the wrath of God. Brothers and sisters, so now God says here, verse 14 again, "And he shall be for a sanctuary, for a stone of stumbling, and for a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel, for again, and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem." Who will be a rock of offense there? Well, primarily it's Jesus Christ. But who was it that Jesus raised there to be a rock of offense against Jerusalem, against the house of Jerusalem. It was Jeremiah. Has God raised up some rocks of offense in these last days against the apostasy of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists? Yes. And who are they? Those who are crying and sighing and doing the work in a self-supported way and irregular way, brothers and sisters. They are the ones. Notice now what Sister Watt says. She says, the church is God's fortress, his city of refuge, which he holds in a revolted world. Any, notice now, betrayal of, what is it? Of sacred trust is treachery to him who has bought her with the precious blood of his only begotten son. So notice now, according to what she says here, the church has been giving a sacred trust. It is the sacred trust that makes us a church. But the moment that we move away from that sacred trust, we no longer God's church. We in apostasy. Therefore, he has to raise a body within that, like the regular line of Seventh-day Adventists, to do the work in an irregular way. Notice now, she goes on to say, in the past, notice now, faithful souls have, notice now, constitute the church on earth. What constitute the church on earth? Faithful souls have constitute the church on earth. Then it says, and God has taken them into covenant relationship with himself, uniting the church on earth with what? With the church in heaven. Who are the church in on earth that are uniting with the church in heaven? The faithful soul, those that remain faithful and are standing firm on that foundation, the rock of our foundation. Then it goes on to say, he has sent forth his holy angels to minister to his church, and the gates of hell have not been able, notice now, to prevail against it. That's Review and Herald, December 4th, 1900. And so God has deployed angel to minister to his church. Which church is that? The church that remained faithful that to their sacred trust that God has given to them. And the gates of hell, like Jesus says to Peter, shall not prevail against them as long as they uphold the word of God. Notice with me now in Isaiah 40 now. We're going to Isaiah 40, same book, but this time looking at verse 40, beginning in verse, chapter 40, beginning in verse 6. It says, notice now, the voice said, cry. And he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is a grass. Notice now, the grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but notice now, but the word of our God shall stand forever. And that's our foundation. And the word there represents our rock and represents Jesus Christ. And as long as we abide by the word, we shall remain forever. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Notice another passage there from Spirit of Prophecy. She says, the great heart of the work is at, and as the human heart throws its living current of blood into all parts of the body, so there's the management at this place. The headquarters of where? Of our church. Notice now, it says the headquarters of our church. That's referring to the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. It's the headquarters, not the church. Notice now, it goes on to say, affect the whole body of believers. So the headquarter now affect the leadership in the headquarter. What they do affect the rest. It says, if the physical heart is healthy, the blood that is sent from it through the system is also healthy. But if this, what is it? foundation is impure. Oh, brothers and sisters, if the foundation is impure, what does that mean then? That means it's a Sunday foundation, referring to the headquarter of our church, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. The whole organism becomes diseased by the poison of the vital fluid. So it is with us. If the heart of the work becomes corrupt, the whole church in its various branches and interests scattered abroad over the face of the earth suffers in consequences. In consequence, Satan's, notice with me now, Satan's chief work is at the where? At the headquarters of our faith. And so notice now, notice the context there. It says, brothers and sisters, please, let's look at this one more time. If, one more time, if this place, the headquarters of our church, is sick, it affects the whole body of believers. If the physical heart is healthy, the blood that is sent from it through the system is also healthy. But if what again? If this foundation is impure, the whole organism becomes diseased by the poison of the vital fluid. So notice now, if the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists becomes diseased, oh, brothers and sisters, and it becomes, and the foundation that they were standing on becomes impure, that means they have moved from the rock of our foundation to the sandy foundation. So what happened? The rest, the whole organism becomes diseased by the poison of the vital fluid. And so then, what must we do then? Jesus says to Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. The Pharisees were standing on an impure foundation. They rejected the rock, brothers and sisters. Seventh-day Adventist General Conference have also rejected the rock of our foundation, Jesus Christ. They have embraced the Antichrist. So that means if we remain there, we'll become sick as well, brothers and sisters. Notice what this article says here. It says, from Zenit, which is a Catholic magazine, October 13th, 2016, quote from Pope Francis now, it's not my Jesus versus your Jesus, but our Jesus, Pope says to ecumenical group. Notice now, this is the Pope now talking to a present ecumenical group. Notice now, it goes on to say, the Pope says, ecumenism has three facets, prayer, service, and blood. On Wednesday, before the audience, general audience, Pope Francis received in audience the participants in the Conference of Secretaries of Christian World Communions. Notice now, Christian World Communions. So it is these are Christians now, Christian denominations now, that come together as one body. And the Bible tells me, can two walk together unless they agree? And also, Sister White says, that type of unity cannot be based on the Bible. We would rather wage war. And Jesus also says, I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Why? The sword is the word of God, the truth, the rock, the foundation. That means we cannot associate ourselves with any so-called Christian groups who call themselves Christians, but they are not standing on the rock of our foundation because of the winds of doctrines that is tossing them to and fro. If we associate ourselves with them, we likewise will be moved by every winds of a doctrine. It goes on to say, the International Ecumenical Association that meets annually in October, so it's a yearly thing. It says, each year in a different country, notice now, to improve, what is it? Mutual awareness. keep those words in mind. Mutual awareness, we'll come back to those words. The same article goes on to say, the conference is made up of the Anglican Communion, the World Baptist Alliance, the Disciples Ecumenical Consultative Council, the Ecumenical Patriarchate, Eastern Orthodox. What follows? General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists was also there. Brothers and sisters, they've been doing this every year. But this came out. This was not just a meeting with an ecumenical group here and there. They went to Rome, brothers and sisters. They represent Ganune, this individual here. He represented the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. They went to the papacy. And the papacy has been calling for unity among all the Christians. And he's been saying the protest is over. Come back to the mother church. They're going to come up with all kinds of excuses. As a matter of fact, I'm going to show you one of those excuses. Why they send a representative, Ganune, there? Why they send him there? All kinds of excuses. But you know what? Unfortunately, many will just see this and read this and just don't do anything about it. Brothers and sisters, are we Bible-believing Christians? We were supposed to check. We were supposed to be the people of the book. To check everything and not go by what men say. We were supposed to be like the Bereans, to go and check these things for ourselves. But yet, Ganune will come out and will give all kind of excuses why it's okay to meet with the Pope, to meet with these groups, because we are, quote-unquote, observers, making sure that they're doing their job right. And then many will just accept that. Oh, brothers and sisters, notice now, this is not just another meeting with a group here and there. They went to the Vatican and met with the Pope and paused in a picture with the Pope. We sent a representative to the Pope to bow to the Pope while all Christian denominations are bowing to the Pope. This was our opportunity to stand up and make a difference. But no, because they're no longer standing on the rock of our foundation. They have chosen another rock. By the way, it's not even a rock. It's a sandy sand. That sandy sand represents the Antichrist. That's the rock. That's the foundation, rather. That's the foundation they have chosen. And we know the end result of that. They're going to perish with the world, brothers and sisters. They have, when the winds come, when the storm comes, then the flood comes, they are going to perish. And notice now, it goes on to say here. Here is Ganune here from Adventist News Network. It says, Adventist leader, new Secretary General of the Christian World Communions, December 2nd, 2014. Dr. Ganune Diop was voted to the new Secretary General at the annual conference of the Secretariats of the Christian, notice now, World Communions. Once a year, secretaries general or equivalent officers from about 20 Christian world communions take part in an informal 2 or 3 day conference to present the work. Notice with me now, why they meet? To present the work done in their churches and discuss current issues. So they have to report to the papacy the work that they have done. Who is their master, brothers and sisters? They are reporting to the Antichrist the work of their churches and discuss current issues. Oh, brothers and sisters, we are reporting to the papacy. Why? Because we are part of this ecumenical movement. We have to report to their new master. Brothers and sisters, this is deep. Notice another one here from Adventist News Network as well. This came out November 17, 2016, and here is the excuse why we are meeting, why we are involved in this ecumenism. It says, why does the Seventh-day Adventist Church have a presence in the public sector? An interview with public affairs. And what is it? Religious Liberty Director for the Adventist World Church, Ganune Diab. What in oxymoron? What do I mean by that? He is one, what again? He is the director of the religious, of the public affair and religious liberty for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now do you see the reason why these men in sheep clothing did not stand for Eric Waltz? Because they were busy bowing, going to Rome, bowing to the papacy. Now, was that a coincidence? The thing about Eric Waltz came about last month when the state of Georgia demanding him to turn over his sermons and his Bibles. Then they came after him and to provide proof that he indeed worked for the Southern California Conference. Where was this man who was supposed to be the director of religious liberty? He was busy bowing to the papacy. Ted Wilson sent him over there to bow to the papacy. Have you heard of Ted Wilson talking about Eric Waltz? No, they were busy. And by the way, the month of October was also the month when this unity come. When we say, or the Protestants, the so-called Protestants says, that the protest is over. You know, let's just join hands with the papacy. That's what the regular line of Seventh-day Adventists was busy doing. And it's mind-boggling to me how many Seventh-day Adventists in their right mind can look at this and still say, well, the church will go through. It says the church will go through. It never says the general conference will go through. It never says any conference will go through. The church are the people who keep the commandments of God, not the organization. Notice now, it says, Dr. Ganune Diab, Director of Public Affairs and Religious, quote-unquote, Liberty for the Seventh-day Adventist World Church, recently returned from, notice now, from two major international gatherings. What are they? A meeting of the Conference of Secretaries of Christian World Communions held in Rome, Italy, and the African, notice now, another one, and the African Council of Religious Leaders, Religions for Peace, which took place in Abuja, Nigeria. He is busy uniting with those who have forsaken the law of God. If you are uniting with those that have forsaken the law of God, which the men of sin has tried to do away with the laws of God, to change the laws of God, then you are no longer the representative of the Almighty God. You are just a regular line, which your foundation now is on a sandy sand. Then, so therefore, those of us who want Jesus to remain the rock of our salvation, we can no longer support those organizations. We can no longer support them. And you can make all kinds of excuses and keep saying, well, we were told not to leave the boat. But the boat has two sides, the regular line and the irregular line. You are supporting them with your tithes and your offering. You are in essence, supporting the apostasy. And so therefore now, you are standing on sand, on quicksand, as a matter of fact. You will be sinking with them pretty soon, because the Bible tells me the papacy will be sinking pretty soon. Jesus is coming again. And so they're making all these excuses. Why? Oh, brothers and sisters, why? Same article goes on to say, it says, Ganune Diab, he is answering the question. The question again was, why does the Seventh-day Adventist Church have a presence in the public sector? Notice the excuse. The first two words, in the name of our department, public affairs of religious liberty. Brothers and sisters, you are disqualified, because we had a brother who was in need of you at that moment, Eric Walsh. But where were you? You were over there bowing to the papacy, because this logo is part of the ecumenical logo. We signed up into this, so therefore you must report to Rome. You should have reporting to Jesus. We should have been on our knees to see how we can help that brother, Eric Walsh, on our knees to get wisdom. But no, we were busy. Ted Wilson is busy traveling here and there and never talk about these things. Because these men, one more time, I'm not afraid to say it. These men are wolves in sheep clothing. And it goes on to say, it says again, the first two words, in the name of our department, public affairs, succinctly describes a core part of quote-unquote mission. Oh, they're always talking about that mission. What mission is that? It's a mission to promote the papacy ecumenical movement. It says, in all our activities, we seek to position the church to a standing of visibility. That is the church militant there. That is not the church triumphant. The church militant is the visible church. The church triumphant is the church that is not so much out there, but is the church that's really in hiding. Like in Elijah's days, the church triumphant was in hiding. And the church triumphant also comes joined with the church in heaven. And because their name is written in heaven, they are the one who are gaining victory over sins. They are the one calling God's people to repentance. They are the one telling God's people, yes, indeed, by God's grace, we can gain the victory over sin. And so he's saying that they are the church, what again? The visible church. That's what it was, brothers and sisters. During the Dark Ages, the papacy was the visible church. But the true church was in hiding, like the world and sins. But they were the church triumphant. This is the church militant there. This is the corrupt church there. This is the church that is standing on sin descend. Then he goes on to say, again, in all our activities, we seek to position the church to a standing of visibility, credibility, trust, and relevance in the public sphere. That means being prepared, notice now, to share the mission and values of the Adventist Church with who? With anyone, whether a public official or representative of another faith group. Okay, now, we're getting somewhere there. So that means when he met there with the Pope and with these other faith groups, he did share the three angels' messages with them. I don't think so, brothers and sisters. I'm just being sarcastic. Brothers and sisters, what mission is he referring to? It is not the mission that Jesus has given to Seventh-day Adventists. It is not the three angels' messages. The disciples were given a mission to proclaim Jesus as the true Messiah that came and that will come again. We as Seventh-day Adventists, we have also been given that mission, but more so had been given unto us to declare who the man of sin is, brothers and sisters. Did he share that with them? I do not think so. Notice now, but let's go back now to the previous article from Zenit. Remember the words again in this last quote there. It says, let's read that one more time. Ecumenism has three facets, prayer, service, and blood on Wednesday before the general audience. Pope Francis receive in audience the participants in the conference of secretaries of Christian World Communions, the International Ecumenical Association that meets annually in October each year in a different country to improve what it is. What is it again? Mutual awareness. So according to what Ganunedia told us, they're just there to observe and to promote the quote-unquote Adventist mission. But this tells me this is to improve mutual awareness. What does that phrase mean, mutual awareness? Notice what the dictionary says. It says, mutual awareness, as a high-level definition, mutual awareness is a practice, neither a state nor a technique. Mutual awareness is about making other attendees in any kind, notice now, in any kind of cooperation, aware of the activities of other group members and the overall progress of the group, hence a practice. So that's what mutual awareness means. So that means they have to report, as we read before, on a yearly basis, even more often than that, to the papacy. What are they doing? So again, go back to the quote-unquote mission. Do you think that they tell the papacy that, you know what, we found in Revelation 14, verses 8 through 11. Verse 8 describes the second angel message. Babylon is fallen and is fallen because she had made all the world drunk of the wine of her fornication. And notice now, Mr. Pope, here's our report this year. We found out that you are Babylon. We found out that your wine is your teaching, your doctrines. You think that's what they've been reporting to the papacy? No, brothers and sisters, that's not what they've been reporting to the papacy. They are in bed with the papacy. They've been promoting the papacy's agenda. So that means, according to Revelation 9 through 11, Revelation 14 rather, according to Revelation 14, verse 9 through 11, which describes the mark of the beast, which also describes the wrath of God that will come upon those who receive the mark of the beast, because they did not heed the call that Babylon is fallen. One, that's the papacy, and is fallen. Two, that's Protestantism. That's apostate Protestantism. And the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists has fallen under that category as apostate Protestantism. Last time I said very clearly, I did not call the Seventh-day Adventist Church Babylon, I called the General Conference of Babylon. But apparently somebody wasn't listening well and accused me of calling the church Babylon. Brothers and sisters, I am a Seventh-day Adventist. But what makes me a Seventh-day Adventist? Not the conference, brothers and sisters. Not the conference that makes me a Seventh-day Adventist. But let me clarify this. I am a self-supported Seventh-day Adventist. I am part of the irregular line of a Seventh-day Adventist. Why? Not because I believe I'm perfect. Not because I believe I am right. As a matter of fact, it's because I believe that I'm not perfect. As a matter of fact, it's because I believe I have not arrived and I want to become perfect by God's grace. I want to arrive in Christ Jesus. I want to gain a victory over sin. And that's the reason why I have chosen to be part of the irregular line of Seventh-day Adventists, because as I look at what is going on, they are bowing to the papacy, and that's the reason why they have changed the great controversy book that describes how we can gain victory over sin, and they have given us the great hopes, or should I say, the great hope. Love is all you need. Don't worry about the sin problem, brothers and sisters. I cannot be part of that because I am a sinner. I don't want to die in my sin. I want to gain victory over sin. And Jesus promises me that I can gain victory over sins. Philippians 4:13 tells me, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengtheneth me. And all things means all things. That means I can gain victory over sin. I can no longer remain on the sandy foundation and claiming and thinking that one day I will gain victory over sin. It's not going to happen. I must follow Jesus. Like the disciple says, we have forsaken all to follow thee. What will we have then? Well, if we have built our foundation upon Jesus, if we have built our church upon Jesus, brothers and sisters, he says to the disciples, whatever you have forsaken for my sake, whether wealth, family, whatever it is, I will give you 100-fold. Brothers and sisters, I'm tired of this sinful world. I'm tired of this decaying body. I want a new body. I want to stop sinning. I want to live a life similar to the life that Jesus lived. I covered this. And we keep going to these, in good conscience, keep going to those regular line churches. I remember attending one of the regular churches, and this pastor was preaching, and he says, we can't get victory, we can't gain victory over sin. Don't worry about it. Jesus did it for us, so we don't have to gain victory over sin. And I'm said, what? Then I'm doomed, brothers and sisters. Then I might as well go gambling. I might as well go do whatever I want to do because, I'm a Christian now and Jesus already did it all. So I'm fine. How can you remain there? And some of you, you know this. You've heard these things before. And you just sit there. You know, I was told not to leave the church. Who told you that? Which church are you talking about? What is a church is the question. What is a church? The conference one more time is not a church. Because if that was the case, Jesus did the wrong thing. When he left for the regular line in these days, he did the wrong thing by going about doing the work in an irregular way. Because the Pharisees says they were the church, they were the organization. But they were not standing on the foundation, on the rock of our foundation. And so we're meeting with the Pope. As you see, Ganune there, not too far from the Pope, to the left side of the Pope. And Sister White tells me here, notice now, she says, when Satan could not induce all the angels to revolt against the law of God, he made the earth the scene of his rebellion. And through the who? The men of sin. And who's that? That's the papacy. Through the men of sin, seeks to carry out his diabolical purpose. Through the papacy, the Roman power, the man of sin, the purpose of Satan is carried out among men. And you mean to tell me, after reading that, you feel comfortable to stand next to the Pope, to meet with the Pope and the other fallen churches, and you feel comfortable with this? It goes on to say, it says, through the papacy, the Roman power, the men of sin, the purpose of Satan is carried out among men. The law and the time of God are set aside. In this, we see that Protestantism is giving encouragement to popery. And then, and false systems of worship against which our fathers manfully oppose themselves, imperiling even property and life, are fostered and cherished and encouraged to extend and gain wide influence. Then, she says, Rome never changes. So what makes you feel? Well, we're going there to make a difference. Yeah, that's why we're meeting with the people. That's why we signed up to be part of this ecumenism. That's why we say, you know what? Our logo, three angels logo, offends people. Let's adapt this Freemason 666 logo. That would not offend people. Then we are following in the ways of the men of sin, and which really working for Satan. She goes on to say, Roma never changes. Her principles have not altered in the least. She has not lessened the breach between herself and Protestants. They have done all the advancing. That's exactly what Seventh-day Adventist General Conference has been doing. Who was making the advances there? It was Kanune. Well, this man was the scapegoat for the rest of Ted Wilson and the others. But all of them, my brothers and sisters, it says, she has not lessened the breach between herself and Protestants. They have done all the advancing, but what does this argue for the Protestantism of this day? It is the rejection, notice now, of Bible truth, our foundation now, Bible truth, the three angels' messages. It is the rejection of Bible truth which makes men approach to infidelity. Who is that infidelity there? That's the papacy. It is the rejection of Bible truth, the rejection of what God has given us, the rejection of our purpose, our true mission, to declare the righteousness by faith in the Son of God only, and to declare who the man of sin is. Notice what she says next. It is a backsliding church that lessens the distance between itself and the papacy. And so notice now, which church there is it referring to? Remember, the boat has two sides. Which side of this boat went to the Vatican and bowed to the papacy, shake hands with the papacy? We in agreement with you. And that's the reason why we have moved or taken out all of these offensive stuff from the book, Great Controversy About You, because we love you, dear Papa. Who is this this church there? Which church is that that's on that boat? Which church on this boat? Is it the regular line or the irregular? That's a regular line that went and bowed to the papacy. It is a backsliding church that lessens the distance between itself and the papacy. How close was Canune from the papacy? He represented, keep that in mind, he did not go there on his own. He represented the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. That's the regular line. And you mean to tell me you still want to be there? Brothers and sisters, even after so many evidences of apostasy, and you still think that I still need to go there and support, and you still feel so comfortable of having this Freemason 666 flickery flame logo on your front door, you still feel comfortable with this? There are many who have come close to tell you it's time to leave the regular line, but they don't say it. But I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, many of you will receive the mark of the beast. Why? Because you feel like it's a sin to be self-supported. You feel like you will not be a Seventh-day Adventist anymore. What makes you a Seventh-day Adventist? Is it the conference, or is it the truth? Remember, this conference, the General Conference, was not established until, 1863? But the church was already there. The church was already there, brothers and sisters. So don't be fooled. We need to wake up and understand what's going on. If we remain there, we will fall into the apostasy as well, and we will receive the mark of the beast. Notice what Sister White says here. From Manuscript Ecclesiastes 19, 383, the night of trial is nearly spent. There's a crisis coming. Satan is bringing in his masterly power because he knoweth that his time is short. The chastisement of God is upon the world to call how many? All who know the what? The truth to hide where? In the cleft of the rock and view the glory of God. Brothers and sisters, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists are not standing on the rock of a foundation anymore. They are standing. They have their foundation built on sandy ground, on sandy sand. There's trial, as Sister White says, coming. There's winds coming. There's a storm coming. It's going to shake everything that is built on that same foundation, with the sandy sand foundation. Notice now, she goes on to say, the truth must be muffled now. Plain statements must be made. Unvarnish of truth must be spoken in leaflets and pamphlets, and these must be scattered like the leaves of autumn. Which book again? They try to scatter like the leaves of autumn, the great hoax, instead of the great controversy. But what did she say? She says the truth, the great controversy, and the Bible contain the truth, brothers and sisters. Here's another one here from Adventist Review. This time, that was in December 18, 2013. World Council of Churches takes wide evangelism stance. It says, another excuse there that they make. The World Council of Churches, WCC, is an interfaith organization that counts membership among most mainstream Christian denominations. Christian unity is a linchpin of the organization and a top priority for many of its key members. Notice now, while the Seventh-day Adventist Church regularly sends observers and journalists to WCC assemblies, the denomination is not a WCC member and remains concerned about, notice now, remain concerned about ecumenism in light of the movement understanding of biblical prophecy. Notice now, that is an oxymoron. We just saw that Sister White said it is a backsliding church that lessens its distance from the papacy. But we're going there. We're not that far away from the papacy. Everybody's going there. We're going there too. What makes the difference? Now they come. This is an excuse, brothers and sisters. They are part of the WCC. But you know what? They don't want you and I to know about it, so they keep it undercover. But notice what this other article says, dealing with the same thing that just happened last October with them meeting with the papacy. It says here, ecumenical, patriarchate, permanent, the declaration to the World Council of Churches. Notice now, to the World Council of Churches. That means all the churches you're going to find there are those who are part of this. But who's there? Notice now. The annual conference of secretaries of Christian World Communions took place in Rome on October 11 through 13, 2016. This informal ecumenical forum that goes back to 1957 sees itself as communions of churches belonging to the what? To the same tradition. Seventh-day Adventists belong to the same tradition as the others? I thought we were a movement. Then it says, and held together by this common heritage, conscious of living in the same universal fellowship and giving to this consciousness at least some structure, visible expression. Then you skip down there. It says, at this year's meeting, reports were given by representative of the Anglican Communion. And then at the bottom, what do you see? The General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. And they're telling us they're not part of the WCC. Brothers and sisters, it's like this secular song. It says, some of the words says, tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. And so many of us, we like this. Whatever the General Conference says, go, even though it does not match with what the Bible says. Just like this woman of the nation, whatever your view, Mark Finley says, on this subject, let's just allow the General Conference make the decision. And whatever the decision they make, just go along with it. Even if it's not biblical, just go along with it. It's like, tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. And we just go along with it. Another one here. Notice now, it says, from World Council of Churches, headline says, faith groups strengthen, notice with me now, strengthen call for climate, what is it? Climate justice. Remember again, November 4th, 2016, they just put the climate change thing into force. But notice what this says here. This came out November 4th as well. It says, faith groups strengthen call for climate justice. Notice now, those faith groups there, it's also referring to the same Christian groups, including the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists that have met together. It's the same group it's referring to. This is the time to step forward and, notice now, act as trustees to what? To Mother Earth. That's pantheism, brothers and sisters. So they have fallen into pantheistic teaching as well. It says, together, by supporting each other's progress, we can go further and faster. Reads the COP 22 interfaith statement. A document prepared by faith communities involved in advocacy work on climate change. This is a document that was put together by faith community. That means the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists was part of that. It says, at the 22nd Conference of Parties of the Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Now, to back up what I just said, notice what they said here. From the General Conference says here about this initiative, taking action on climate change. Notice now, from Adventist Review, December 3rd, 2015, This was during the time when the nations came together in Paris to work out a solution on how to tackle climate change. Remember again, behind climate change is a call for Sunday law, the papacy tells us. Notice now, Seventh-day Adventists reaffirm commitment to preserving the environment. They're not talking about the way God says to preserve the environment. They're talking about, according to their boss, their Antichrist, the papacy tells them they have to abide, bow, and talk like the papacy. It says, as world leaders gathered in Paris for the 21st United Nations Climate Change Conference, the Seventh-day Adventist Church supports and applauds the efforts of these leaders to come to an agreement to stem the deterioration of our earth due to climate change, encourage all members to be good stewards. Which members they are encouraging? Those who are still supporting the regular line. But notice now, climate change is a hoax. It has been proven it is a hoax, but the General Conference is repeating the same lie. The papacy been telling the world. They said again, one more time, it says, the Seventh-day Adventist Church supports and applauds the efforts of these leaders to come to an agreement to stem the deterioration of our earth due to climate change, which is a hoax. That's not the reason why, brothers and sisters. This is happening today. It is because of the breaking of the laws of God. And so, as the Bible tells us here in Isaiah chapter 3, this is what's happening here. And they're causing God's people to err. They are taking us down to the way of the papacy. It is a false foundation. Isaiah chapter 3. And then notice verse 12. Isaiah chapter 3 verse 12. As for my people, this is an appeal to God's people. It says, as for my people, children are their oppressors, and women rule over them. O my people, notice now, they which lead thee, cause thee to err, and destroy the way of thy paths. They have destroyed the way of the path that God has chosen for his people. They have done away with the great controversy, the path that God has chosen for his people, the way to gain a victory over sin. They remove all of these things, and they have given us the great hopes. They are telling you right now that the problem the planet is facing, it's because of climate change, not because of the sin problem, not because of the breaking of God's law. So they have destroyed the path that God has destroyed. They are men in sheep clothing, but they are wolves, brothers and sisters. They pretend the papacy will never change, but they are siding with this men of sin. And so because they say that they are the so-called voice of God. And so this is what they use against many Seventh-day Adventists, because they read here and there where Sister White says they are the voice of God. So therefore, even though they're in error, you still need to support them. You still need to support the apostasy. You still need to be part of the regular line of Seventh-day Adventists. But what did Sister White says later on as she saw the apostasy that was coming in? Notice what she says here. She says, let those in America who suppose the voice of the General Conference to be the voice of God become one with God before they offer their what? Their opinions. Then she says that these men should stand in a secret place to be as the voice of God to the people, as we once believe the General Conference to be. That is past. She also says the present showing is sufficient to prove to all who have the true missionary spirit that the regular lines, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, may prove to be a what? A failure. If it's a failure, brothers and sisters, if it's once the voice of God, but no longer the voice of God, then brothers and sisters, we must be self-supported to know the voice of God for ourselves, instead of relying and thinking that, well, I don't want to get kicked out if I speak out. Well, if you know the truth shall set you free. If you know, brothers and sisters, that they are in apostasy and you try to speak out, or you believe that if you speak out, they will kick you out. So be it, brothers and sisters. Make a stand for Jesus, because the apostasy will not get better. It got worse. It's getting worse and worse and worse. Notice another one here. It says, from the Spectrum magazine survey, the Adventist vote and the 2016 national election, November 10th, 2016. The survey is being conducted by researchers at the Washington Adventist University and Andrews University, encouraging Adventists to vote when we were told not to be engaged in voting and putting people in office, brothers and sisters. Because whatever agenda, whatever sin they commit while in office, we are responsible for this. And here's another one from Adventist Review, November 17, 2016. It says, Washington Adventist University Nursing Program gains what? Accreditation. It says, Washington Adventist University, which operates one of the oldest nursing education programs in the state of Maryland, receive five-year accreditation for its undergraduate and, what is it, master's level nursing programs from the Council on Collegiate Nursing Education, located in Washington, D.C. Notice now, we are what? Very pleased with these accreditations, as they reflect, notice now, the hard work of our faculty and staff and the high quality of our nursing program. So they make it sound like we are getting a higher education, because why? We have these accreditations now. But what counsel was given to us when it comes to going to the world, going to the state, and to try to call to get to be part of the so-called higher education? Notice what this says here. It says, I'm instructed to say that in our educational work, there is to be no compromise in order to meet the world standards. That's the world standards there. She's referring to accreditation. It says, God's commandment-keeping people are not to unite with the world to carry various lines of work according to the world's plans and the worldly wisdom. Our people are being tested as to whether they will obtain their wisdom from where? From the greatest teacher the world has ever known, or seek to the God of Ekron. Let us be determined that we shall not be tied as much as a thread to the educational policies of those who do not discern the voice of God and who will not hearken His commandments. And so, notice now, so which God again that we are looking to when we go, when we have our school, when we go to the state and have our school accredited and say, well, we have this so-called higher education, a bachelor degrees of this, master of this and that. So we are looking to the God of Ecron, because that's not part of the true education that God has given us. This organization have moved completely away from every single principles of God. And notice another one here from Spectrum magazine, May 9th, 2016, Sanctuary Fund for Conversion helps, notice now, churches constructively address LGBT plus issues. A sanctuary for conversion, living, loving, and learning at the 2015 North American Division called Ministerial Convention in Austin, Texas, a large convention hall full of Adventist ministers worked through the Sanctuary for Conversion materials together. We aim to create safe spaces for positive, healing, informed, authentic conversion. Do you know what's speaking here? when they use terms like safe places, they're saying, let me put it very bluntly for you, they're saying we are a sodomite denomination right now. It's okay to have homosexual. We have several churches right now that have gay elders and even transgender elder. Oh, brothers and sisters, this is happening rapidly throughout this denomination. And so, brothers and sisters, you still want to support this sodomy that's going on? We still need to return our tithes there. Oh, the conference is the storehouse. Where does it say this? Where does Spirit of Prophecy says this? As a matter of fact, if I recall correctly, while there was apostasy within the General Conference, Sister White was returning her tithes to support those who were doing the work in a self-supported way in the South. And notice with me now, this is an untempered mortar, a shaky foundation. Ezekiel chapter 13. We're going to the book of Ezekiel chapter 13, and God is coming to judge this regular line of a Seventh-day Adventist, and they represent the same group in Ezekiel chapter 8 who are bowing to Babylon, who are worshiping the sun, and who receive the wrath of God. Ezekiel chapter 13, and notice with me now, beginning in verse 10, and the Bible says, Even because they have seduced my people, saying, what is it? Peace. When they went to the papacy, when they met with the Vatican, isn't that what they're saying, brothers and sisters? Because the Vatican is calling for peace and unity. So isn't that the same thing they're saying? When they went there with the Vatican. So it's another way of saying there's nothing going on between us and the Vatican. There's no great controversy. Peace, just relax. It says, because they have seduced my people, saying peace, and there was no peace. And one built up a wall, and what happened? And lo, others dubbed it with untempered mortar. Say unto them which dubbed it with untempered mortar, that it shall, what will happen to it? Fall. There shall be an overflowing shower, and ye, O great hailstones, shall fall, and a stormy wind shall rend it, brothers and sisters. So the appeal, again, is to you, is to me. The winds, the rain that shall fall represent the Holy Spirit. We are expecting the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Only those that are crying and sighing and who believe they can gain victory over sin. When that storm comes, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, like the winds and the storm, they are the ones who are going to be blessed by that. But you know what's going to happen? Those are brothers and sisters who are in apostasy, but or who are following the conference who is in apostasy, many of them will not recognize this, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Because to them, that storm and that wind that will come, it will be a stumbling block. But to us, that rock is our foundation. It helps us to stand fast. We need the Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters. We need the Holy Spirit. The regular line in the disciples, they did not receive the outpouring of the winds and the rain and the Holy Spirit, the fire that came. It was the disciples who had forsaken all to follow Jesus. God is calling you and I to forsake all. Our reputation, which is one of the main things that many have a problem with when it comes to living the regular line. They look at their reputation. I was so-called born in the church. You were born in the church. What does that mean? Were you born in the conference? Even being born in the church does not guarantee you that you will make it to heaven. Notice now, it goes on to say, lo, when the wall is fallen, shall it not be said unto you, where is the dubbing wherewith ye have dubbed it? Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, I will even rend it with a stormy wind in my fury, and there shall be an overflowing shower in mine anger, and great hailstones in my fury to consume. So will I break down the wall that ye have daubed with untempered mortar, and bring it down to the ground, so that the foundation thereof shall be discovered. Why? Why would the foundation of that wall that's supposed to be safety, why would the foundation of that wall be discovered, but be revealed? Because when the wind comes, when the rain comes, when the storm comes, it blows, it's taken all the sand away, then the foundation is revealed. Notice now, it goes on to say, so again, verse 14, will I break down the wall that ye have daubed with untempered mortar, and bring it down to the ground, so that the foundation thereof shall be discovered, and it shall fall, and ye shall be consumed in the midst thereof, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. Thus will I accomplish my wrath upon the wall and upon them that have daubed it with untempered mortar, and will say unto you, the wall is no more, neither they that daubed it, to wit, the prophets of Israel, which prophesy concerning Jerusalem, and which see visions of peace for her, and there is no peace, saith the Lord God. Notice now. So God, therefore, now is calling a people, because the wall there represents safety, represents protection, or the wall, or the law of God. There has been a breach through the walls of God. God is calling for those who will repair this breach. Go with me now to the book of Isaiah chapter 58. So God is calling some to be repairers of the breach there. Notice now in Isaiah 58, cry aloud. Isaiah 58 verse 1, cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people the what? Their transgressions, and the house of Jacob their sins. They have transgressed upon or against the laws of God. So we need to cry aloud and show them their sins, because there are many within the regular line of Seventh-day Adventists who do not know this, who are being deceived. So we must call them. God needs some restorer of the breach, like the Bible tells us in chapter 56, and to call God's people. That's part of the three angels' messages. We have many preachers among us who are only preaching one side of the three angels' messages. They're only declaring the sins of Babylon. Whenever the Pope does something, they put it on Facebook, make video on YouTube and what have you, but never touches upon the sins of Israel. We need, God needs some repairers of the breach. And notice what it says here. Still in Isaiah 58, but this time, notice now, in verse 10, it says, if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry, and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and thy darkness be as the noonday. And the Lord shall guide thee continually, and satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden, and like a spring of water whose waters fell not. Notice with me now, verse 12 of Isaiah 58, and they that shall be of thee shall build the old places, the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the foundation of many generation, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. And those that have been called here, the repairer of that breach there, are those who will be part of the church triumphant. Notice what Sister White says here. She says, characteristic of true reformers, here are, based on Isaiah 58 here we just read, here are given the characteristics of those who shall be reformers, who will bear the banner of the third angel's message, those who avow themselves God's commandment-keeping people and who honor God and are earnestly engaged in the sight of all the universe in building up, what is it? The old waste places. Who is it that calls them? The repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in? It is God. Their names are registered where? In heaven as reformers, restorers, as raising the foundation of many generations. Notice now, it says their names are written where? In heaven. So they have become part of the church triumphant because their name are written in heaven where the church triumphant is, where the heavenly, the invisible church triumphant is. And so therefore, this is describing a people now that have gained victory over sin, or I should say, that are striving to gain by the grace of God victory over sins. So the true reformers will dig deeper and will have a strong and deeper foundation. Luke chapter 6, we're going to the book of Luke chapter 6 and beginning in verse 46. And brothers and sisters, we have been called to be the repairers of the breach, and those that God had called there in Isaiah's day to be the repairers of the breach, where those God had called to do the work in an irregular way. Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Notice now, and why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever, notice now, cometh to me, and what happened, and heareth my sayings, and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which, what again? Built a house or a church, and dig, what is it? Deep, and laid the foundation on a rock. Oh, we must dig deep. Not, brothers and sisters, go back to the surface and have a shallow foundation. What happened again? And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. And so that's the rock. We must dig deep to find that solid rock. Oh, that solid rock, like the song says. That's our Savior, Jesus Christ. Ephesians now, the book of Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 19. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20, we're looking at here. It says again, now therefore, ye are no more what again? Strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. And are, what happened? Built upon the what foundation again? Of the apostles and prophets. And what's the true foundation? Where did the disciples get the where to find that foundation, or where to build rather that foundation? They dug deeper until they found that rock, Jesus Christ, being the what? The chief cornerstone. Notice what Sister White says here. She says, there is a life beyond, an eternity, a life of happiness. Notice now, no death can enter there. There will be no what? No malarial tent there. No sickness or pain or sorrow. Do you not want to be there? The streets are paved with gold, and you will see the King how? In His glory. Brothers and sisters, just reading that may not make a big impact. But to see the King in His glory, how would that be possible? When the Bible tells me that when the Lord comes, sin will be obliterated. The wicked will be destroyed by the brightness of His coming because they have sin in them. But in order to see the King in His glory, notice now, I must be there, she says. I must see the King in His majesty. Notice now, don't lead people to believe they can go there and take what? Their sins right along. Oh, brothers and sisters, who was leading us to think that we can get to heaven with our sin? The General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, when they change the word of God last year at the GC session, where it says holy men of God, according to 1 Peter there, holy men of God speak as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Well, they changed that. They changed it to holy persons of God, gender fluidity. They are the sheep, in the wolves rather, in the sheep clothing. They are the ones who are telling us that all we need is the great hoax, not the great controversy, which tells us how we can gain victory over sin. There's a war raging, a great controversy. It's a great controversy, victory over sin. There is no controversy with the great hope. So don't worry about the sin problem. So they're leading you to think that it's okay. Now they are bragging about 20 million members. Brothers and sisters, how many of them understand the sanctuary message that indeed they have to gain victory over sin? How many of them understand that? I bet the majority, brothers and sisters. And the leaders are responsible, and they're going to have to answer to God. And she goes on to say, characters must be changed where? In heaven. Is that what it says? Here. Notice, we must learn to sing the songs of the redemption here. Notice now, the song of the redemption, that's the church triumphant. Then it says, if we ever sing the songs of redemption in heaven, notice now, the church here, we must learn to, again, to sing the songs of the redeemed here. If we ever would sing it in heaven. Well, what's in heaven? It's a church triumphant. So that means the church here that will make it to heaven will have to be like the church triumphant that's already in heaven. We'll have to have the same characteristics. So we have the church militant and the church triumphant. Which church you want to be in? I want to be in the church triumphant. It says, if we ever sing the songs of redemption in heaven, sing of God's goodness, talk of what? Talk of His grace. And brothers and sisters, we must learn here to gain the victory over sins. Many will be deceived. Many will be lost because they are following a false shepherd, a false leader, a false organization that's not standing on the rock of our foundation any longer. But because they deceive many and they hide it in such a way that you cannot really see it. But the Bible is plain. Spirit of prophecy tells us that. And you can see from the articles. It's time, brothers and sisters, to come on that side of the boat, as I've said so many times. Jesus loves you. He came to save you, not in your sin, but from it. And He's coming for a church without spot and wrinkle. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, which art in heaven, Father, thank You that You have given us Your word to stand on a firm foundation. The enemy is busy, Father, is very cunning and is deceiving many. Father, have mercy upon us. Forgive us, Father, when we fall short of Your glory. Help us, Father, to fight this good fight of faith, to gain victory over sin until Jesus comes, so we can stand in His presence. We want to be with You in heaven. Be with Your people in a special way. Help us to make tough decisions that will bring glory to Your name. And help us to not look at our present circumstances, but look at what You have promised to us to give us. Thank You for the promises. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.